So friends, good evening to all of you and welcome to this exciting health talk on the very important topic of the taking care of the mind, and this very, very important in this difficult time, that difficult phase what we're passing through. And to talk on this particular topic, we have once again with us the very renowned geriatric consultant, Dr. Prem Narasimhan. He had been with us last month to talk on the managing of multiple medications in the elderly person, and that was a fascinating discussion. And today, Dr. Prem is with us to talk on this important topic of how do we take care of our mind. May I request Veena Madam to please formally introduce him and to please take it forward.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to one and all. Welcome, Dr. Prem. Dr. Prem is an MD geriatric medicine and consultant geriatrician, elder care specialist at Jastlok Hospital and Research Center in Mumbai. Jastlok has a dedicated one-of-its-kind geriatric care department, and Dr. Prem is heading that department, and he is very passionate about spreading the word on the importance of geriatric care management and services of senior citizens. Dr. Prem literally lives up to the word elderly care, and his mission is enhancing the quality of life of the elderly. Despite his tight schedule as a consultant and at the hospital, he keeps giving talks on awareness about geriatric care. And there is a lot to learn, and he doesn't talk just about physical. He talks on the mental aspects like we are going to hear today. And unke naam jaisa jo prem hai, unko bujurgon se bahut hi prem hai. And there is always a lot of takeaways in his talks. God bless you, Dr. Prem. Go ahead and enlighten us on the mental aspect of today's topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sengupta, and thank you, Veena Ma'am, for the introduction. So I think mental health is just too relevant. It was always relevant, but somehow always pushed into the background because physical health always seems to be having symptoms. तो जब भी हम मेंटल हेल्थ की बात करते हैं, चाहे मानसिक शारीरिक जो बात होती है, शारीरिक के बारे में कंसंट्रेशन ज्यादा होता है, और वैसा नहीं होना चाहिए. क्यों? क्योंकि दिखता है. जैसे इफ समबडी हैज अ हार्ट अटैक, देन देयर इज अ पेन इन द चेस्ट एंड पीपल गेट रियली वरीड एंड देन दे विल गो इमीडिएटली टू द डॉक्टर ट्राई टू मेक श्योर दैट इट्स नॉट अ सिग्निफिकेंट इशू. बट दैट इज नॉट ऑलवेज द केस विद मेंटल हेल्थ. अगर आपको लो लग रहा है, आप किसी को बताते भी हैं, तो बहुत सारे लोग बोलते हैं नहीं ठीक हो जाएगा, मे बी आपका बस लो ठीक है, थोड़ा पॉजिटिव रहो. बट इफ इट इज कंटिन्यूसली देयर एंड स्टिल यू डोंट सीक हेल्प, आई डोंट थिंक दैट इज राइट. बिकॉज एंड स्पेशली व्हेन यू गेट ओल्डर, बिकॉज टेंडेंसी ये रहता है कि नहीं इस एज में मैं हेल्प क्यों सीक करूँ, मैं इतने साल मैं ठीक था या ठीक थी, आई वॉज ओके फॉर ऑल दिस टाइम, सो आई रियली डोंट नीड एनीबडीज हेल्प. So sometimes it's there, or sometimes it could be the attitude of the caregiver also, ki nahi, this is all part of aging. So you don't really need to focus on this. You'll be fine. Thoda TV dekh lijiye, ya thoda apna time ye kar lijiye. So those things are important. But that is not the way it is. Or sometimes mental health can really be bad, and then it can affect your physical health also. So both things go together. And as of course, as the definition of health goes, health is a state of physical, mental and social well-being. So physically and mentally, you both have to be strong. Socially, you have to be strong, socially connected. Then only you will be able to be mentally and physically strong. Now what happens in bahut sare logon mein ki mujhe blood pressure hai, sugar hai, dil ka daura hua hai, I'm having a heart attack, I have a history of stroke, there are medications. But I am not interested in taking the medications because I feel that what is there to live for? Maybe there is nobody at home. So then ultimately, if you're mentally down, you might not be wanting to take care of yourself physically also. So that's why that is the importance of mental health. Now, as you get older, of course, there are a lot of ways that you can see that mental health can be an issue or can get worsened. Mental illness, सबसे बड़ी बात है, इट्स नॉट अ नेचुरल पार्ट ऑफ एजिंग. यू शुडंट थिंक दैट जस्ट बिकॉज यू एज यू विल हैव मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज. नो, द मोस्ट कॉमन इंक्लूड ऑफ कोर्स मेमोरी इश्यूज, व्हिच इंक्लूड डिमेंशिया, अल्जाइमर्स, देन डिप्रेशन एंड मूड डिसऑर्डर्स, and anxiety disorders. Now, what are the risk factors which usually can trigger or can lead to a risk of mental health illnesses? One is, of course, alcohol or any substance abuse. Then dementia-causing illness like Alzheimer's. Some illness or a loss of a loved one. If a loved one is actually ill, then mentally you feel down. Then long-term illness. It could be anything like cancer, heart disease, maybe stroke. Having chronic pain. Then medication interactions. Then physical disability or loss of mobility. Loss of the quality of life. Loss of your independence. That is a great downer for your mental health. Physical illnesses to a great extent can affect your emotion. It can affect your memory and also your thought process. And then having a poor diet and malnutrition. These are all risks for mental illness. Now, how do we try to assess if you have a mental health disorder? Just by seeing that whether you are doing your life tasks and self-care activities like dressing, preparing meals. Are you even interested in looking good? Are you interested in looking good at all? Safety, including your financial safety, physical health. Do you have pain, loss of appetite, any uncomfortable symptoms? What is your mood? Do you have feeling of hopelessness? Is there a loss of interest in activities you actually enjoyed? Then medication safety, including are you actually skipping your medications? Are you not concentrating on medications and the fact that there are side effects and you're just not interested in doing anything about it? Now, how do we see our mental health changes? How can we see in older adults? One is, of course, suddenly there is a change in appearance or dressing, not able to maintain your own home. Things like confusion, disorientation, problems with concentration, decision-making. Decrease and increase in appetite. So that will cause changes in weight. So both extremes are bad, having a low weight also and having high weight. Then depressed mood lasting longer than more than 2 weeks. Feeling of worthlessness, guilt, helplessness, repeated thoughts of suicide. Then memory loss, especially recent and short-term memory problems. A lot of times physical problems which cannot be explained. Jaise kahin bhi dard ho raha hai, repeated constipation. Now a person who loved being socially connected suddenly withdraws. Loss of interest in doing things which were otherwise enjoyable. Then trouble in handling finances, working with numbers, always trying to sleep, having real energy loss or loss of sleep completely. That is insomnia, not sleeping at all, getting anxious about small things, getting fatigued very easily, not able to explain why you're actually getting fatigued. Just a general sense of low being throughout. Not knowing that what you should do to improve it. So that also is something which can sort of really hurt you or hit you. Now, the most important thing is you should not hesitate to seek help if at all any of these things are there, because that hesitation is just too obvious. Now, what is important is to pamper your mental health and to be positive. So how do you sort of do that? Now, common stressors are again something which I would like to talk before going into that. See, suicide is also very common in the older adults. Remember, they might not gather the confidence or the guts to do it. But once they do it, they know pretty well how to do it, one, and they will be successful also. Why I'm saying is because there are just too many things. One is already an aging body, access to medications. Already they might be on medications and maybe they might already be living alone or isolation, people not maybe taking care of them, or they are just living alone. People don't even know how their mental state is. So that risk factor is always there. The common stressors always include physical health problems. We know as an older person that as we age, there will be a wear and tear of our body, no doubt, because the body works hard. But if there is chronic pain, heart disease, stroke, chronically bedridden, then it becomes a source of stress. Losses are a very important part, unfortunately, a hard fact of aging. It could be loss of a person that you love, could be a spouse, could be friends, could be colleagues, could be of your age group, could be younger people. Then other losses which are very important include loss of independence, then mobility, a loss of status and roles. and loss of self-worth. Now, by status and roles, I mean somebody who is a great person in the sense that professionally a CEO of a company, but one day after retirement, not a CEO anymore. So suddenly they feel, am I actually not good enough now that I was, or maybe should I just have worked together? That's why we say there is no age for working. You should continue to work however you want to. One, two is always plan your retirement. Everybody keeps thinking that they will get retired and then I will be doing this, I'll be doing that, I'll have a lot of time, but suddenly a lot of older adults realize that there is nothing to do and then it becomes a burden on their mental health. Then social isolation. Now this could be because of maybe change in lifestyle, health. A lot of older people tend to become isolate themselves. Now how it's happening now, outings have become infrequent and maybe not possible for a long time. And once the social isolation sets in, it has a negative impact on the mental health. That's why we keep saying now in COVID era, please wash your hands, wear your mask, and have social distancing of 6 feet, as we say, 1 meter. But do not be socially isolated. You have to be connected to your family, friends, whatever the way it is, whether it's a call, whether it's a WhatsApp call, whether it's a WhatsApp video call, whether it's Skype, whether it's through Zoom. Be in touch with everybody purely because that's the way you have to go ahead, LA, this particular time, because these times will take time. I mean, we've already been 1 year down the line. Maybe we might be into 1 year more, but you have to be prepared for that. And that's how you have to be socially connected. Now, changing living arrangements. Most elderly like to live in, but sometimes they might have to move in with their children or move in a home purely because of deterioration of health. That is a big change as far as the mental health is concerned, because it's like, this is my house. So I love that environment. It's not easy for everybody to adjust to a new environment, the routine and independence. The change in role and status also might be there. In my house, I am the boss. When I go to my children's house, I feel I am the boss, but am I the boss? Purely because, or you just directly say, no, 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 this is your house. So the son or daughter, you are the head. I'm just here. So that role change can also affect an older adult mentally. Then financial stressors. I think financial stressors at any age is a problem. Everything is going fine. You have saved enough. But then suddenly an illness comes, or maybe you are hospitalized and all those savings have to go, or you might need the savings which you have actually done for a normal life. So that can be difficult for elderly with pension. Yes, it's okay. For a without pension, they might actually entirely have to depend. And if they are not working, of course, after retirement, they might actually have to entirely depend on their children, which is not always, not that they don't want it, but then I think most older adults want to be independent in the last day of their life. Even financially be independent on their own. And it can cause difficulty in adjusting, especially if there is an obvious stress or a problem in the relation with your children or with whoever you're trying to live with. That doesn't help, because then it becomes a compromise. Then lack of activity. I think staying mentally and physically fit is very important, but there is no lack of activity, so the mental health will obviously get more and more worse. Now, how do you improve mental well-being? That is what we want to talk about today mainly. So certain good tips which are there is, one is eat well. Always try to eat the right amount, whether it's healthy whole grains, fruits, vegetables, pulses, they are the way to grow. Do not go into too many sugary foods, because a lot of times you might feel a high initially, but you get tired after that. Healthier foods always absorb much, much slower, and you are able to get a better quality as far as your mental health is concerned. Then sleep. Sleep is very important. Good sleep is very, very important, especially in older adults. Already generally it is said that older adults are light sleepers, not necessary. You might have a good, maybe a bad quantity of sleep, but your quality of sleep might be still good. So sleep is very important, because it will improve your concentration. It will improve your memory, restore any kind of cell damage, and overall it will also add to your immune system. So immunity is something which we are talking a lot these days about. So sleep is very important for you to have a good immune system. Then exercise regularly. I think exercise gets improves mood and well-being. It helps in improving the mental health. Why is it good? See, it's a double whammy. By exercise, you're also improving the physical health and you're also improving the mental health. So it's double the advantage if you exercise. And that is horribly gone down for a lot of people during the lockdown. They say sedentary is and sitting is the new smoking. Imagine yourself to have just sat and not exercised for the last 1 year. Obviously, your muscles will go weaker, your bones will get weaker. So no, at home also, whatever the space you have, if you used to take 10 rounds or 12 rounds, whatever in your garden, you might not be able to do that now. Make sure you walk front and back, maybe in a straight line 20 times, 30 times. Try to do it the same way, but do it. Then maintaining relationships. I think maintaining relationships are very important because good relationships are a backbone of good mental health, whether it's family, whether it's friends, because it contributes to your happiness. And it's not only for your happy times, but if things don't go well, then it helps you cope with the stressors and also helps in basically supporting you if at all you need help. And to motivate yourself and de-stress yourself. Then always take out time for enjoyable and relaxing activities. That's why it's the importance of having hobbies. It could be anything. It could be acquiring a new skill, maybe trying, maybe a laughter club, even online, maybe getting to know a new language, meditation, singing, or maybe just closing your eyes for half an hour and thinking about nothing. Whatever de-stresses you, you should do. And your hobbies are very important. Could be gardening, could be anything. But it should give you a sense of contentment and satisfaction. When you have times on your hand, make sure, and we do have a lot of time now. So try to make sure that you put it to best use, whether it's online courses, offline courses, whether whatever you can do at home, whether you want to cook something in a new way or some new cuisine. Just do everything now because you might have it, you will be having time, and put it to the best use. Take care of yourself also in this time, because maybe this is the time you might have best for you. Then spirituality and religion. I don't really believe that just because you age, you get into religion or you get into spirituality. If you were always religious, if you always believed in a spiritual sense of mind, then you would do it. It is something which is inculcated or which grows as you age. So it is just a myth that just because you're 60 plus means you have to start going to satsangs, or you have to go to the temple more often, or you have to read the scripture. Now, a lot of people do it out of interest purely because they don't have the time. So they want to know where they come from, whether it's about reading the Gita, whether it's the Quran, whether it's the Bible, whatever it is, whether it's the scripture, whether it's stories, or whether it's shloka. So people just want to know where they come from and try to take out a sense of meditation out of that and spirituality. But it is not necessary just because you're old means you have to sort of do it. If you feel like doing it. But it has to give you satisfaction and peace. If it does give it to you, then you should really do it. And it also helps a lot of times, because in satsangs and pujas, it's all about community, it's all about social. Which is cut off now. If it happens online, good. But when in usual times, it is great because people get together and it's always good to be in a community. It helps your social well-being. Then, as you're already seeing, turn to technology. Turn to technology to stay in touch, whether it's mails, whether it's messages, whether it's WhatsApp, whether it's Zoom, whether it's Skype. Continue to do so. Continue learning more. There was a workshop which was conducted by one of the instructors I know, in which old people were taught PowerPoint. And they were told that maybe in a week you have to tell us what all you need to do or you need to say. So it was discovered that older adults who were learning ended up discovering things which even younger people didn't know. So it is about being organized. And older adults usually are. They have their experience and they have their organized. So that's why there is no age for learning. So you should continue to learn and continue to turn to technology, whether it's Facebook, whether it's WhatsApp. Make sure that you don't spread all the wrong messages, because a lot of WhatsApp fake news also goes around, especially now. One of them is, of course, the nebulizer giving you oxygen, which doesn't happen. So I'm just saying, there's a lot of things which are fake. So it is a responsibility, because as older adults, we are a part of a lot of WhatsApp groups. I know that very well, because I also am as a younger person. So you should make sure that you try to digest what is and see whether there is any amount of truth to it. And then only try to spread, because you imagine in a day, how many people actually spread it around. And that becomes very important if it's fake news. Then there is something known as a very interesting concept known as flow. Now, you should create a flow. Now, flow is basically a unique state of being in which a person is so engrossed in doing an activity of interest that they feel a sense of contentment and try to spend more and more time doing that activity. It could be anything. It could be meditation, it could be badminton, it could be gardening, painting, chess, any form of artistry, pottery, cooking new dishes, trying new cuisine, going into crafts. But this should be, it should be an activity which gives you basically a challenge so that it feels right. It shouldn't be too easy, it shouldn't be too difficult. If it's too difficult, you will not want to do it. And if it's too easy, then it will become boring. So you shouldn't do such activities, but create a flow. Try to be so engrossed in an activity that you feel like doing it again and again. And there is a sense of peace in it. Then I think gratitude is very important. I mean, nobody more than you yourself will be able to tell me, because you have seen almost a lot of things in life, whether it's personal, whether it's professional, whether it's with family, whether it's with finance, whether it's ups, downs, whether it's joy, whether it's sorrow. So always better to just take a pause and say that, yes, all this I have achieved. All this has happened with my life. And try to get that positivity and increase your less of levels of happiness. This can be done by just keeping a track. Make a diary. Acknowledge all the things that you actually have achieved and lucky to have. I am lucky to have a family. I am lucky to cook the meal I cook. I am lucky that even in this pandemic, I am connected to so many people. Whether it's through technology, it doesn't matter. And just keep writing it to remind yourself that feel gratitude on a longer on a regular basis, because not everybody could have had it. And yes, try to also spread happiness in other people's lives. That's the next point. Give to others. Believe me, performing acts of kindness is very, very important, because it gives you a sense of happiness yourself, sense of relief, and it's obviously making somebody happy. So it could be anything. It could be volunteering. It could be teaching younger children if you're a teacher. That is known as intergenerational bonding, wherein two generations actually bond together. You teaching them, you telling stories, you making them their time very interesting, maybe joining an NGO. It always doesn't mean donating somewhere. It could be just donating your time. It is not always a finance. Donate your time to make a difference in others' life. And a lot of older adults are doing that. And a lot of older adults are already doing it. So try to do that, because it gives you the other sense of happiness, a sense of fulfillment. Then learning. I think go back to school. Learning is very important. The brain becomes very bored doing the same things. Learn new skills. It could be anything. It could be a new language. Learn to play games, video games maybe. Learn new things to create new programs. Maybe try to make short videos, maybe get into a photography course, anything that you feel is interesting and you want to do, you should do, because the brain gets bored. New skills, and with your organization and your experience, I'm sure you'll be able to do it very easily. But try to do it, and that will give you another sense of fulfillment, happiness, and your mentally you'll be much, much happier. And of course, there are other ways, like getting a pet, taking care of a pet, whether it's a cat, dog, whether it's birds. That also gives a sense of happiness. It is likely to improve your satisfaction and well-being. Then play games. Could be anything. Puzzles. It could be maybe in your friend circle, playing with the family. Just minor things. That could be something which is sort of obvious, helps in developing things. Then laugh. I think laughing on yourself, even joking at your own expense, that is also a kind of an art, just to keep things light. Be with people who make you laugh. Be with people who are more optimistic in life and not pessimistic. If people are pessimistic, try to get them out of that pessimism and try to inject a lot of optimism in that. So in general, trying to be happy. I think the most important point of all still is always be in control of your health. Remember, if your physical health is not good, then it becomes difficult. So whatever diseases you have, keep them in control. Take your medications on time. Eat healthy diet. Do your exercise. Try to be in touch with everybody. Try to be in touch with your doctor. Now, through teleconsultation, telemedicine, it's not necessary that you have to go to the doctor. You can directly maybe talk to them online, like you're talking to me now on Zoom or any other channel. So that's how you should be in touch with your doctors. And if you need to do investigations, then of course, timely investigations can be done through, because people come home and take. Now, the more healthier you are, the more happier you will be, and the more time you have for exercise, the more mentally fit and mentally healthy you will be. Now, all these things obviously will help you in coping and lead a happy and fulfilling life. But it's important, if you are still not able to do things, if you are still not able to cope, if you think that ability is diminished, it's always a great idea to seek help. It could be anybody. It could be me. It could be an elder care specialist. It could be your own spouse. It could be your friend. It could be a diary in which you are writing. But if it's not making you feel better and you're only writing, then please try to express to others. It could be ultimately a psychiatrist, a psychologist, somebody who gives you an ear, or somebody gives you a different perspective. And try to work on your mental health, because ultimately most mental health disorders are treatable. Depression is treatable. If you don't treat it and discover it later, then it becomes very difficult to handle. So try to obviously more and more think about things which keep you happy. Like somebody mentioned about memories. Yes, all memories are important. You might have so many. Positive ones are very important, which keeps you happy. Maybe negative ones make you learn. But try to make yourself happy. Mistakes are done by everybody. But keep your mental health strong by making sure you're physically strong, and vice versa. You have to be mentally strong and physically strong so that you have an overall sense of health. Then another way of improving your mental health sometimes is, if things are not getting better, whether it's on a family front or this, sometimes you have to let go. Because a lot of times it's just keeping, not letting it go, having grudges from the past, that just makes you maybe just eats your head, and then it doesn't help. Then with people who are very close to you, whether it's children, whether it's friends, family, who you consider very close, and things are not working out, as an older person, try to make two steps forward and expect them to make two steps forward, and try to meet in the middle. Yes, sometimes things might not work, and maybe you'll have to keep it that way. But what is important is to keep in your mind that it's not always that the younger generation or the younger person should only be doing the steps. Yes, you also should do, and try to meet it in between. Because I'm not saying it's a compromise. It's there that both of them are trying to come in a common pitch. And that's the way things can improve. Because these are all stressors which hit you mentally, and they create a lot of negativity. So it's very important that sleep also has improved for mental health. So for sleep, it's the good sleep hygiene. Do not basically try to see a lot of blue screen or a lot of TV before you actually sleep. Try to eat comparatively earlier, maybe 2 to 3 hours before you actually want to sleep. Make sure that the room is darkly lit, does not have too many lights. You want, maybe have some soft music, which soothing music, which puts you to sleep rather than something very hard. If you avoid drinking a lot of water, avoid drinking caffeinated drinks in the night, because that can also decrease your sleep. So sleep is very, very important for your mental health as well. So overall, I would say one should work on their mental health to a significant extent. Do not neglect it just because there are no symptoms. There are symptoms, sometimes you just don't recognize them and just trying to put it under the carpet. One is, another thing with mental health is the taboo. The obvious taboo that anything talked about mental health is that either it's the person itself is mental, or there is a psychiatric disorder, or the person is psychotic. Not everything which is a mental health is psychotic or is psychiatric. Yes, depression is one of the psychiatric disorders, anxiety is, but it is treatable. So that's why if you don't address it at all, then it becomes a problem. So in a way, the pandemic has actually helped us. The pandemic has helped us to talk about mental health to a great extent, because if these things existed before, but nobody was really talking about it much, purely because it was all physical health. But the pandemic showed us that people who are physically fit can also have a great deal of mental stress, because suddenly they couldn't go out, they couldn't do their exercises, they were just secluded at home, having their relatives, children in the same city, not able to meet, sometimes in the same building also, and not able to meet purely because of the social distancing and all those things which have to be done. Another silver lining is you should understand that when you are pushed mentally, you also up the game. Older adults do that. So you went into technology. You learned the technology, and I'm sure a lot of you people 1 year ago, maybe in Jan 2020, wouldn't think that I actually need to be on Zoom and talk to a lot of people. To be very frank, I didn't even know the Zoom app existed. A lot of people didn't know that. We only knew that, yeah, there are video applications which were hardly used. But now if you see, seemingly the possibilities are, the sky is the limit. So that's why try to just see the positive aspects. Even in the pandemic, see the positive aspects. Yes, be smart. Being positive doesn't mean being foolish and irresponsible. Wear your mask, get your vaccination if you are in favor of it. Make sure you work on your immunity. Don't forget your diseases. That's how you will, physical fitness and mental fitness are interrelated. Take care of your brain. Give it challenge, because that will also help in improving your mental health. And never shy away from talking about your mind. I'm not saying shy away from talking your mind. Sometimes that can be a problem. But don't shy away from expressing what you feel up and low, because it only helps. It only helps you in not keeping the emotions bottled up, because ultimately then it would just come out maybe as an outburst or something at a later part, or it will never come out and you will go into such amount of depression that you will not even know what we need to do about. So I think it's most important that you just forget the mental part out of the mental health and try to pamper your mind, try to pamper your mental part, and make sure that you reach a good amount of satisfaction in what you are doing. Being unhappy, I think, is very easy. Being happy and content is difficult. Because, if you talk about, I can quote the example of maybe the person who lives on the street, if he gets that particular night's food, he sleeps pretty well that night. But at the same time, if you have to compare a businessman might be having all kinds of, you can say, facilities, but he might not sleep well. So it's very relative. So happiness and content is something which you should always see. Of course, I don't mean that there is any age of ambition. No, you should be ambitious at any age. You want to do anything. There is nothing known as second innings. It's always a continuous innings. You only decide when you want to take a break, and you can. And you can get onto the saddle whenever you want. But remember that when you get older, it's your time. Maybe most of your responsibilities are already over, which we, to be very frank, in India, it's believed in. Abroad, it happens very early. In the United Kingdom, people leave their homes as early as when they are 16 or even 14. Whereas in India, we are still very much well taken care of by our parents, even to that extent. And people actually fund their own education as they are even young. So, and another thing I would like to tell you is, always mentally don't feel down and draw inspiration from nobody but the person you look into the mirror, that is yourself. Because you must have done so many things in your life, tackled so many situations, that is inspiring enough. Be your own inspiration, and if you can inspire yourself, try to inspire others. Because that's what matters as far as mental fitness is concerned. But don't neglect it just because it doesn't have a particular chest pain or it doesn't have a dizziness, or maybe an arm which is not working, or maybe a difficulty in walking. No, you need to express yourself. Easier said than done, but a lot of older adults express to doctors quite easily than even more their own relatives. Not because they don't want to, but they feel that there is a different perspective. So the bottom line is, mental fitness is as important as physical fitness. That's why they keep saying that sharirik, mansik and samajik, if you have to say it in Hindi, these three are something which go hand in hand. They cannot be divided. And take care of yourself in the best possible way. That's what we do. Sometimes you might have to help yourself if there is no help, but always seek help. Always stay positive and try to see there is always going to be a better tomorrow. On that note, I like to thank everybody who has with great patience heard me, and I'm ready to take any questions, comments. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Dr. Prem. The floor is now open for question and answers.
Sir,
Mr. Ramani, please go ahead.
Doctor, quite often elderly people are accused of being senile. They have senility or so. Is it a medical condition or it's only a social condition?
I think it's just something which people end up saying, that you are senile. I don't like the word senile, buddha, and ye to just old ho gaye. These are all terminologies, to be very frank. And you can brand everything to aging. I think it's just something known as ageism, which is not a technical term. Senile dementia or senile osteoporosis are technical terms. But the word senile per se, just because saying that they are just because they are old means they won't be able to do this or do that, is just a myth which has been created, because it's not their age which matters, it's the way the people are. If it's a 95-year-old who's independent, able to do everything, then age is nothing. But if it's a 60-year-old who has got a lot of diseases, who can't do, then age only doesn't matter a lot of. So it's always the whole picture. A person cannot be just branded on age, just because age badh raha hai, toh they are senile. So, no, I don't believe in it, and it's not something which should be believed in at all.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah. Nita madam, please go ahead.
Yeah. Can we take sleeping pills for can we give sleeping pills to a patients, insomnia patients? Is it okay?
Yeah, it's okay, but it would be ideal that you don't give it yourself. A doctor should.
No,
the reason I'm saying, why I'm saying, is a lot of times it happens that you might be on sleeping pills and your husband or your friend or somebody must not be getting sleep, and they'll be like, you have, so why don't you give it to me? It shouldn't be done that way.
It happens, yeah.
No, it should never be done that way, because there are side effects.
Okay.
Yeah. Can I ask one question?
Yeah, thank you.
Hello. Yeah.
Yeah, Agarwal,
hello, can I ask one question, please?
Please go ahead.
Doctor, I just want to ask you one thing. Normally, sleeping pills are supposed to be bad. But sometimes what happens is, either due to the skin itching problem or problem related to prostate and leading to more frequent visits to bathroom, the sleep gets disturbed. And at times, you don't get sleep for hours together. In that case, is it okay to take Esprinjol on an SOS basis?
I would still say, if you have to take any amount of sleeping pills, you shouldn't be taking it yourself. It has to be prescribed one. Because always the lowest dose is started first, and then we see if you have any side effects, and depending on that, it is continued. So not on your own, your doctor, whoever is taking care of you, should have the knowledge that you are actually trying to take it.
No, doctor has okayed that on SOS basis you can take, and
if the doctor has said SOS, then it's fine.
So it's not a regular thing, but once in a while, you know, maybe once in a week or once in 3 days, four days.
But if you have any side effects to that also, you should be telling your doctor.
No side effects. Yeah. Thank you.
Good evening, doctor. How to cope with the death of a friend or family?
I think it's one of the most difficult questions to answer. Purely because there is a period, of course, there is something known as a period of bereavement, in which obviously somebody who have lost, you will feel very much down about it. But if that continues, For example, if it's a month, if it's 2 months, fine. If it's 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, year, then it is going into something known as a depression. So that is not bereavement anymore. So we always try to differentiate between bereavement and depression, one. Secondly, how to cope with it? One is, of course, how strong the family system is. If you have other members in your family, obviously it becomes easier to cope because loss is a part of life. It is going to happen, especially as you get older. Secondly, you should always remember all the good things that particular person had. It depends, of course, a lot of times if the person has really struggled towards the end of life, then it is actually good riddance in a way. Nobody should go struggling and really suffering towards death. Peaceful death is always good. So that is what, you know, a person who's coping should think. And always take positive things, the memories that you have with that particular person, and the fact that there is much more. You had a great time with that particular person, but there is a much more things to actually live for. And ultimately, you will be able to experience more things in life because death is a very much a part and parcel of life. And everybody knows life has to end someday. But usually with older adults, it's the way they go that matters to them. So I would say that is the best way to sort of cope. A bit of self-help, but at the same time, if you're not able to cope, then you should go for help, whether it's professional help in any way. It could be a friend who you're expressing to, or it could be a family member, or it could be a doctor. I mean, at any stage you should. But a lot of times, a lot of people don't feel at all. By don't feel, they are just in shock. So it doesn't happen for a month, 2 months. There is not even a single tear, even a tear coming out. It's just a matter of shock. Those people should be really looked after very closely because it's like they are not expressing at all. So if that happens, then of course there have to be ways it can actually be got out, because that can be very precarious because you don't know whether the person has taken it well or not because there is no expression.
Hello, can you ask a question, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, please go ahead. Please go ahead.
See, I have a question. See, what happens, you know, this negative thoughts, you know, the always, you know, when you get negative thoughts that disturb the mind and it affects the physical health also. So how to have control on your negative thoughts? That's my question, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, to have control on your own mind, if you know about it, then you should tell me also, because it's one of the most difficult things. But yeah. I feel when you do things which give you in peace, which actually take you to that zone, then you are very much in control on your mind and no kind of negative thoughts actually affects. And it could be anything. It could be, it's sometimes music for a person in which that particular, it's a total bliss that no amount of negativity can breach that. It could be meditation or it could be totally nothing. For certain people, it's just closing their eyes and thinking about nothing. It's me time. It's me and nothing. Mm-hmm. And people do that. Or people just go to one part of the house and just stay there for maybe 15, 20 minutes just to make sure that there is no negative thought coming. But if the negative thoughts are coming again and again, then you should always think what is positive in your life. But I'm sure because there's always things which are positive, and then you will be able to defeat that negativism. But if it's continuously going into negative thoughts, then and you need help, that is where you should seek help. Because we tend to just push ourselves a lot. Sometimes we just tolerate, and it reaches a stage where that we are not even positive enough to seek help, because to seek help also you want to get better. A lot of times you can give no negative, so negative that you're like, why the hell should I seek help, because it's not going to help me at all. So it should never reach that stage. Always think of positives, because it cannot be possible that you have only had negatives in life, because it's always sort of a balance. Sometimes more negative, more positive, sometimes more positive, less negative. But yes, everything cannot be positive forever, because that doesn't, I mean, life doesn't work that.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Doctor,
hello.
Okay. Can I ask, is journaling will help to write and sit back and look at it objectively?
Yeah, it only helps if you write a journal and try to analyze it. Mm-hmm. Or it can also work if you just write it for it. You write it and then it's just a let out. And then you forget about it.
Yeah, right.
Analyzing can help or not. Sometimes analyzing can be over analyzing, and you are all obviously breaking down things so much then it complicates your emotions and you're like, oh, these things happened, so why did it happen to me? Shouldn't have happened. Should I have been more this? Or you just let it out, write it in a journal, and you are like, I have just written it out, taken it out, and forgotten about. So I think both ways can work. It depends on what works for you, because a lot of people write and analyze, but a lot of people just write and that is closure.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, doctor.
Yeah, tell me.
In this pandemic, I'm very people oriented. I really miss my friends and family a lot. How to cope up with that?
You have to be in touch through, I think, the social media. There is no other way out. I know physical touch is very important, but it's just not possible now, and it's not going to be possible for a while. So we always, as they say, it's necessity is the mother of invention, or you always say that we need to adapt, and adaptability always is the key to a longer life. Because if people who live long purely adapt to situations, it cannot be that they just live long because it's a magic trick. No, it's not. Whether it's any situation, I'm saying. So this situation, when we know very, very, you have to be smart. We know that we cannot get, it is just not going to end like this. Be in touch, but that is most important through the social way, whether it's through chat, whether it's through phone calls. For example, if you used to go and just meet them for a small, maybe a small party at home or outside, you just have the same thing, but on video. Try to substitute it, because see, even for other people who used to just go and talk in the park in the evening, substitute it. I mean, the talk is not going to change, but you should keep doing it, or else what happens is you just keep thinking it's not happening, I'm not able to go, I'm not meeting them, and then you feel that, oh my god, actually I don't have friends when I actually wanted them the most. So no, I don't think you should think that way. The best is to be in touch in whatever way possible. Not everybody is technologically wanting to be in touch, whether it's a phone call, whether it's anything should work, but be in touch. I think that's the thing.
And the adaptation, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, doctor.
Sir, what are the side effects of sleeping pills, sir?
You can become very drowsy.
I know, beyond that.
No, that is one of the most. You become drowsy, you fall. That's the end of story. You can have dizziness.
Drowsy means generally sleeping pill we take in the night time only. In the night time you sleep. In the morning.
No, a lot of people have a side effect continue to the next day. That's why we say that the dose matters a lot. Because sometimes people take increase the dose themselves without informing. So apart from that, sleeping pills, by mistake, if you take it in the morning, can be an issue. In the night, if you have to get up for walking, I mean, if you have to get up to go to the toilet, that can be an issue because you'll be very drowsy because of the sleeping pill. Then apart from that, of course, there could be a fall. There could be an imbalance. There could be dizziness. So all these things are usual common side effects. So the dose matters a lot, most importantly. The smaller the dose, the better it is. And then slowly and steadily, if more dose is needed, then it can be sort of increased in some time.
Or ye bones ko effect karta hai kya, sir? Bones will weaken karta hai kya?
Yeah, in long term, it can to an extent, but your bone health is something you have to take care anyways, whether you're on sleeping pills or not. Because the risk is too high. As you get older, especially in women, osteoporosis is very common because of menopause. Hormones go
any direct connection between the sleeping pills and the bone health?
No, it's basically side effects. On long term, it can lead to bone architecture getting worse.
Okay, thanks.
Hello, doctor. Can I ask something?
Please go ahead.
Yeah, actually, you said that playing video games and solving puzzles will keep your brain active. What if somebody gets addicted to that throughout the day, playing video games and solving the puzzles?
If you have time to get addicted to it, you should do it. That's a very good answer. Yeah, purely because, see, we keep talking about addiction when we are younger, purely because there is a lot of things still to do. So if you're not doing your homework, that's what we were always told. You're not doing your homework, if you're not playing outside, because that is something which is commonly happening now. A lot of people are not going out I'm not even talking about now. Children are more focused on playing video games than going out and playing out, which is what has reduced as we go ahead. I mean, to be very frank, I used to do a mixture of both. Going out was as exciting as basically playing games as well. But if you like playing games, and to be very frank, as you grow older, you are very much able to organize yourself better, that you will not keep it to a position where it actually makes you addicted. But if you have the time and you want to do it, and it doesn't start affecting your other things, for example, routine things that you want to do, then it's fine. But if it starts affecting, then you maybe will have to channelize the number of hours in which you want to do. Remember, the time is yours. You need to, you can bifurcate it in whatever way you can.
Okay, thank you so much. My husband will be really happy with this.
Sure, sure. Whatever suits in stimulating your brain, that should be good.
Any other question?
Sir, I would like...
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
I would like to ask one thing now. Due to this pandemic time, most of the time we see that we say, okay, 6 to 8 hours or 4 hours. But it so happens that we are tuned that even if sleep at 1 o'clock, you get up again at 5 o'clock and do the routine and then go to bed. Is it okay? Because sometimes I sleep part sleep in the afternoon. But sometimes it is you sleep at 10 o'clock, again 2 o'clock, you're awake. Again, what to do next? So we start reading or whatever little activity. We can't go out. Is it okay? Because I am not taking any medicine for that. Only I am doing little of the eye exercise and little, you know, hand movements, Vastrika and all the breathing, and then go to sleep again. Thank you.
Yeah, so if you are getting up after 4 hours and you do a very light sort of thing which puts you to sleep, it's not a problem. It's usually not a problem. But if you do an activity which actually stimulates you completely that you tend to lose sleep, then that can be an issue in long term because then you're not sleeping at all. So usually people do get up after 4-5 hours and then they don't get sleep for some time, do some light activity which can induce sleep. So if that is the case, then that should not be a problem. But daytime sleeping should not be a lot. As I said, it should not cross more than 45 minutes. If it crosses 1 hour, 2 hour, then it becomes too much. If it is more towards the evening, then it will start affecting your night sleep.
Night sleep, yes. Thank you, doctor. Thank you.
And then somebody has written in the chat box, if you don't get the solution to puzzles, you get tensed. You don't need to get the solutions. You have to do the puzzle for the fun of it and try to challenge yourself. Do not see it as a task.
Doctor, I wrote it. If you fail till the solution is given in the newspaper on the next day, you remain tense. That's what I meant.
It's not like an exam result anyways.
That's true.
But yeah, I mean, you're stimulating yourself to do puzzles. It's good. That is something you should continue.
Just a minute, doctor.
Yeah, yeah.
I just want to say something. Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, please.
Please go ahead, ma'am.
Hello, can you hear me, doctor?
Yeah, yeah, please go ahead, ma'am.
Can you hear me, doctor?
Yeah, yeah, I can hear you. Yeah, I can hear you, ma'am. Please tell me.
Just a minute.
Please go ahead.
Doctor,
please
can
go
you
ahead.
Hear me?
Yeah, yeah, I can hear you.
Can you hear me, doctor?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I'm Shashi Rastogi speaking. Actually, I love to do Sudoku. I'm not very good in maths, but somehow I have so much of interest in doing that. And easy ones I can do. And the difficult ones, you know, as sir said, ki next day that answer comes. So I feel very happy even next day I take little help and then I can solve the problem. So that gives me happiness that yes, I can do something. And I really engross in that and keep thinking and then how to put the numbers and all. And it's very interesting to do. This is what I do.
No, so you should do it. See, what I also say as far as puzzles are concerned, not everybody likes doing them. Whoever likes doing them should do it. Whoever doesn't like doing them should have an alternative. It's not necessary that everybody has to do Sudoku. Everybody
can't hear you.
I said it's not necessary everybody has to do Sudoku or everybody has to do puzzles. But if you are happy doing it, then you should do it. Ultimately, you should be happy doing it. And at the same time, it should be challenging. If it's something very simple, then you will lose interest in some amount of time. So that difficulty of problem should always be there. It should be a grade which increases.
Yes,
not necessarily difficult first time because you might not end up doing it again ever.
Right, right.
Slowly and steadily you go to another grade.
Yes. I can solve the easy ones.
Yeah.
And I feel very happy, satisfied.
Yeah, yeah. So that's what
it's very interesting to solve that.
Sir, after the second dose of vaccine, I had little pain and all. I have not taken the Indomedicine. Is it okay if I take paracetamol?
Paracetamol you can take.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Any last question? Okay, then we had a very, very fascinating session by Dr. Prem. I think he gave a lot of tips. But the most important point thing that we should keep both our physical body as well as the mental body, mental faculties very strong. In addition to the social health as well as the financial strength. I think you gave a lot of tips to us and it was extremely useful to all of us. Look forward to meeting you on some other occasions. Thank you very much. Sir. Many, many, many thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Prem.
Thank you. Thank you,
Thank you, Dr. Prem.
Thanks a lot.
I'm in five more groups.
Very useful.
Thank you, Doctor. Somebody's
nice.
Thank you, Doctor. It was a nice session. Interesting session.
Thank you. Thank you, Doctor. Very nice.
Thank you, Doctor. 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 Thank you, Doct